the packet that you have is pertaining to this whole section we're going to do. So it's all the toolkit information. And the first thing you're going to see, it was on the left side, I know you guys have been scarfing through it, so it could be out of order, is what's on the screen right now, which is the toolkit links. The reason we want your email address is not so we can put you on spam lists. It's so that we can, although that's not a bad thought, no, I'm just kidding, is so that we can send you this Word document so you'll have live links to click on, so that you don't have to type these giant links and hope you get it. So we will be emailing it to you as soon as this is done. But we're going to utilize the document today to kind of click inside of it to get access to things. And another disclaimer is I'm using a Mac, and I'm not a Mac user, so we'll see how this goes. So it'll be interesting. So really quickly, the first thing, of course, is our website, the TNSTEP.org website, which, like Karen said, we'll have our YouTube videos and all kinds of great information on it. We also send out an e-newsletter too, so that's part of it. So the other next thing is in your booklet, you're going to see what's called Dude, Where's My Transition Plan? Obviously, this is geared towards students. So it's a great tool to use, so we'll go through it just really quickly. It is downloadable. We also can send you some if you need some, so be sure to contact our office if you need any of these. So when you turn to the first page, it talks about what is transition. So I think not only is this helpful for students, but it's really helpful for parents, because parents really just kind of don't understand that word. We have a lot of acronyms and big words that we use in special education, and you know, sometimes it helps for people to read and just really understand what does transition mean and what am I supposed to be thinking about as we transition when children are 14. So it talks about how it affects the IEP and all those kind of things, and it goes through it. Let's see. If we find the page, it talks about strengths. It's got, you know, things the kids can answer inside the book. Then I really like the one that's got the referee on it. It's a few pages in. So it's great because it lists high school services and adult services. So it kind of gets parents and students thinking about life after high school. What are they going to need? For instance, my daughter is high-functioning autism. So some of these adult services she may or may not need because she's in general education. She's probably going to college. So, but she may need some of these. And for certain, you know, she'll need to access the college services when she goes to school and learning how to do that for herself. There's also information back, if you keep going back, there's a true-false quiz, which I like. But it's healthcare too. My daughter has medications she takes every day. Does she understand those medications? Does she know how I order them for her? You know, what's her doctor? How would she call her doctor? All those kind of things that as an adult she'll be responsible for, unless I choose to stalk her the rest of her life, which could happen. That's entirely possible. So anyway, so that's kind of the book, and you can look through it, but it's a really wonderful resource for parents and for kids, and kids like it because, of course, it's very vibrant. They like lots of color and things, and even though it's not clickable, it's not a website, it's still great, I think a great tool for them. So then in your packet, you also found just an overview information sheet about STEP. We also have brochures, so if you need any more of these for families, if you're making a family information packet, let us know. It goes over the trainings and information that we have. So then we're going to talk about a thing that's called Dream Builder. So all this stuff is from STEP, from STEP's website. So the green, you had a green sheet in your packet, and it's an overview of the Dream Builder card activity. So Dream Builder cards is something, actually it originated from Karen, from her daughter. You know, parents have been driving the process so much with their kids, it kind of allows the student the freedom to say, this is what I like. I like church activities, or, you know, I like animals. And maybe they've never had animals at home, so that's something new. And if you kind of let the parents step out of it and let the student really say what they're interested in and segregate the cards into sections, you can use it, you know, we've used it with students like for setting classes and all that. So it's a great tool. And we do sell these sets at our office. But so that's that green sheet for you guys. Then the transition guides is the next. And there's 9 of them. So they're the very colorful sheets, all these colors. So you can see the various topics like self-advocacy, a parent's role, self-directed IEPs, job seeking. So they've got a lot of great tips on them. They do have some websites that people can go to for more information on them. And again, you know, all these are available in our office for you if you want to include them in any packets to parents. But you can also view them, like I said, on our website too. All right, so now we're going to move on to the State Department of Education. And I included a little email that I got from Blake Shearer. So it just looks like an email. And very quickly, how many of you know that the transition group within the State Department of Special Education is working on a thing called the Transition Blueprint? Have any of you heard of that, the Transition Blueprint? Okay, so we've got one. So what the Transition Blueprint is, it's going to be kind of a catch-all, one-stop shop for you guys to go and get like assessments. And you can put in a criteria for a student maybe that's having, you know, difficulty expressing themselves. And so it allows you to find the right assessment. And so it's going to be, like, he's got a list there, age-appropriate transition assessments, developing high-quality transition plans, transition services, supports and partnerships, and career development. So they've been working with all these providers so that you guys, kind of like what we're doing here, you're hopping around place to place trying to find the right tools. The state's hoping to have one site where you guys can come to get what you need. So they're hoping to have that released in October. And I'd like to encourage you, if you're not already signed up, they have a information thing they sent out called Transition Matters. So on the clickable links, we'll have it where you can sign up for Transition Matters. See right here where it says clicking here. So you just basically fill out your information, and it will, then that way you can go and fill out and get that information. There's also, I don't know how many of you go on their website, but they've also got a work-based learning, and I put a copy of that in there for you guys about their work-based learning, frequently asked questions for special education. So that's a copy there. So they've got a lot of stuff on their website, but I'm really excited about the website that they're developing for transition. So stay on top of that and, you know, be looking for that to come out this fall. Because trust me, after doing the research for this and trying to pull together all the links, you realize there's so much out there, and I know you guys just don't have the time to sit and explore everything that's available to you. So how many of you are familiar with Tennessee Works? So good, new information. So Tennessee Works is a collaboration in part by the Vanderbilt Kennedy Center of Excellence in Developmental Disabilities. They have a really great newsletter, so you can sign up for their newsletter. I'm going to have the link for you also. So it kind of talks about how training related to young people with disabilities, how they can thrive in the workforce. They do amazing videos. They're really so cool, and they're great for students to watch. So we're going to watch one of them that I think you're really going to totally enjoy it, but we're going to go to their website.
What is self-advocacy?
Self-advocacy means speaking up for yourself.
Self-advocacy means making your own decisions.
Self-advocacy means understanding your strengths and weaknesses.
Why is self-advocacy important?
Live as independently as possible.
Pursue your goals after high school.
And take control of your own body and health.
Manage your own money.
Get the services and help you need.
You can advocate for yourself on several different levels.
Entering personally, self-advocacy involves making decisions with friends and family. For example, you may aspire to your parents that you want to learn to manage your budget or your own.
Group self-advocacy involves places of work, school, and social groups. You can ask for accessible technologies for your class.
system level advocacy takes place on the larger level, such as government or organizations. Some examples may be talking to your legislators or being involved with Special Olympics.
How can I speak up for myself?
Get to know yourself. Make a list of 5 things you are good at and 5 things you need to work on.
Then write down 3 places where you advocate. Is this school, church, or where you work?
Learn your rights and responsibilities.
If you have a disability, you have the right to a reasonable accommodation at school and work.
A reasonable accommodation is a change made at your work or at school to adjust to your needs. It's your responsibility to know what your reasonable accommodation is and how to ask for one.
For example, you may need an interpreter or need help reading instructions. Make a list of what accommodations you need at school and at work to be successful.
Make sure to speak up when you need to.
Share your thoughts and opinion in class or at home with family.
Ask questions if you don't understand something your teacher, boss, or your doctor says.
Talk with adults and friends planning your class, activities, and life at the graduations.
Create an advocate team. Make a list of people you know well and you trust to help you become a strong self-advocate.
You can list friends, teachers, principals, and academic advisors, coaches, religious leaders, counselors, and doctors, or family members.
Being a self-advocate is all about being assertive and respectful.
You have a right to speak up for what you want and need, but others are more likely to listen and work with you if you appreciate them as partners, not enemies.
And remember, you're on the same team.
You have the power. Being a self-advocate is rarely easy, but never forget that you deserve the life you want and have the power to make it happen.
And never, ever give up.
Okay, so anyways, that's Tennessee Works, and as you can see, they've got a whole lot of information, newsletters, all kinds of stuff for you guys, so I hope you'll get on their website and look around, but they have tons more videos, case studies. Maybe you've got students with particular interests, so they've got different people with disabilities doing those jobs, and so it walks through those, and like I said, they're very vibrant. I think, don't you think students would like them? They really keep your attention. All right, so that... Now in your handouts, you're gonna see something that looks like this. It's a multi-page. So this is called ONET. How many of you are familiar with ONET, have used it? So some, okay. ONET is an amazing tool for researching jobs, industries, all kinds of things for students. And we're gonna go through it and kind of walk through some of the basics of the site, because the site is huge and you could really get into it, but I tried to spend some time on it to try to figure out what really you guys could probably use the most. Okay, so that's what I'm saying. It's kind of cluttered, the front page. This is the very first page of ONET when you open it up, and we'll go to a more student-friendly page. I'll walk you through that, but you know, for our purposes, we'll start here. So what I always think is the most important is help, you know, help, I'm trying to understand this website. So they have a help tab up in the corner. The help is great because it really breaks it down what you're trying to figure out about their website, because like I said, there is a lot on this website, so the help feature is great. So we're gonna, in there, in your packet. Let's see. The very next page, if you turn to the second page, that's what the help page looked like. So I did a printout of the help page. So if we were to click on, this is the scales, ratings, and standardized scores, and that's like page 3 of your packet. So that's what it looks like, but it gives you an idea of what it means when it's scoring something, how they came up with their scoring system, because you'll see every job has kind of rankings and systematic scores and all that. So this explains that process, which is helpful, I think, when you're trying to come up with, you know, the right job fit for students. So that's what's on the next few pages, what that looks like. So that's page 3 through 5. So then we're going to go back to the home page. I'm just going to hit the back button. Oh, back again. Okay, so on the home page, we're going to click on the Find Occupations, which is page 6. I've got it circled on yours, what we're going to do. So from drop down, you can pick different options. So that's where I said it's really got a lot of layers. This is a huge website. So we're going to go down to industry. So under industry then, there's another drop down. So you can, if you say a student's telling you they're interested in a particular industry, that's how you could start. But we're going to select construction. Okay, so when I'm on construction, that's what's on page 7. That's what you're seeing, is the printout of that screenshot of page 7. So under construction, it talks about, let me see my notes. So there's just a lot of options you can do. And so here, if you look at it, you can sort it. These are all clickable sorts by the code. They have everything coded. By the occupation, so it would be alphabetical by occupation, so like all the helpers would end up grouped together. So by projected growth, projected job openings, so you can tell it how you want it to sort. So employed by industry, so it just actually came up with roofer helpers as a bright outlook, and that's what I like too. It gives you what they think the industry is going to do in the future. So if we click on roofer helper, it tells you, see if I've got that on the next page. Okay, so right here, this is what I was going to show you. See where I'm moving right here? It says save table. It's tiny. So you can actually download this information into Excel. So you don't have to keep, if you've got a student you're working with at roofer helper or construction's their interest, you don't have to keep coming back to the website. You can put it in Excel, and then you can sort it, save it, print it for your student so you don't have all this data. So you can do what you want with it, which is a great way to dump off the data. So that's what the printout is on page 8 of your packet, is what that ends up looking like once you dump it out into Excel. All right, so then I go back and I'll click. So the roofer helper, so this is what, on page 9 of your handout, this is what that roofer helper looks like. So it lists the tasks. So it only displayed 5 of 18. So if you hit the plus, you can see all of them. So it expands. So it's just not this ginormous thing, because I only printed out part of it, but it keeps going down, you know, to see all the different aspects of a roofer helper, which is, I think, really great that it does list all the job responsibilities, all the skills you have to have, what kind of training you have to have. You can see, you can also pick details, which is a little bit of a different view. It tells you in detail a little bit more of, like, from more to, you know, least, how much you have to do of those particular tasks. So in all my time, I've never seen jobs broken out. I mean, this is a roofer helper. Look how much, you know, data they're giving you about this one particular job. I think it's amazing. Yep, so that's page 10 of your handout. It shows you the data. So if 11 shows you, if we were to dump out the tasks onto Excel, that's what it looks like. So again, you have the option, you know, when you're in this details section, to go up and again, if you can see where I'm circling up here on the screen, right up in here, every time you see save table, it will dump all this detail out for you in Excel. Because sometimes, I don't know if you're like me, you go to a website and you find great information and you bookmark it, but it never comes up the same because you didn't do the download or drop menu. So I think this is a wonderful way to allow you to create like a Excel file or something for a student and just keep building on it. So if you go back, well, if we click up here and we go to custom, so you're like, what's that? So custom report allows you to tell it, I want to display, you know, 5 tasks. So you can reduce this. I want to do 5 tasks or all or whatever you want. So that says 10. So then I want, you know, tools, technology, knowledge. So this is all the things it covers: skills, ability, work activities, just interests, work styles, all the different information. So you can create your own custom report where when it dumps, it doesn't dump all of it. If you're not interested in those categories, you can custom come up with a custom report and print it off. And so you'll see, I just, that's the 12 is the screenshot of that. And then page 13 is I did a custom. I only selected a couple of things and did a custom of it. And again, you can, like I said, dump it off. And this is the pretty self-explanatory part. We'll get to what I think's amazing about it here in a second. But it's really, we're just going through the basic data of it. All right, so then we'll go back to the home screen. So now we're going to look at what is advanced search, which is the center. So that's on page 14 where I circled, this is advanced search. And this is so you guys can have this to walk through the various steps to understand how to replicate what we're talking about today. So what you can say in advanced search is you can go, well, I don't really know what the student's interested in, but we know what the student's abilities are or what their limitations may be. So you can click abilities. And this is so interesting. I don't know if you see this. It says cognitive abilities, physical, psychomotor, sensory abilities. So it's going to take into consideration your student's strengths and different abilities in selecting jobs for them that are suited. Because it, I don't know about you, but you know, you grow up in a family and you see what your parents did or your grandparents did, and that's what you're familiar with. And even as educators, that may be the same case too. So we're not exposed to all these different jobs potentially. So this really, to me, opens up a lot of different possibilities for students. So this is, to me, what's really exciting about this particular website. Okay, so on page 16, we're going to select physical abilities. So that's what this looks like when it comes up. So it's really cool. It talks about, it describes it. That's what's even better. Dynamic flexibility, what is that? The ability to quickly and repeatedly bend, stretch, twist, reach out with your body, arms, and or legs. So, you know, think about a student that has that ability. And then it talks about gross body equilibrium, stamina. You know, students that have stamina, what's their ability? So we're going to pick gross body equilibrium. So what it did was it ranked them by importance. How important is gross body equilibrium to these jobs? So dancer, that makes total sense, doesn't it? A dancer would have to have gross body equilibrium. But number two, you know, we were looking at roofer helper, so roofers need it. Think about that. They're up on a roof. They have to maneuver. You know, they have to be climbing ladders, all the things that they have to do that job. So that's what's on page 17, is that, to kind of show you that. So anyway, so there's so much more. I didn't really go into every single job, but I think that is a fascinating, really useful tool that's contained on this website that maybe a lot of people haven't discovered if they've utilized it. Okay, so we're going to go back to the home. And this is what they call crosswalks. So let's go to crosswalks. Is interesting because you can pick, like it says, apprenticeship, DOT. Here's the occupation handbook. So we're going to go in occupation handbook. And then we're going to select our roofer helper. And by doing that, you can just type in like a word, helper. You can type roofer. You know, if you have a job that you think, you know, somebody said the word to you and you just want to find it, just type in the word, you know, hair, whatever, and it, beautician, it'll come up. So there's our roofer helper, because all the helpers came up because I typed in helper. So if you see, everybody came up. That's page 19 of your handout. So that shows you kind of how to look that up. So if we go back, we're going to go back to the main page. So that's those three, these three across the bottom. And just a basic kind of understanding how to use them. So, like I said, this isn't really for students. It's kind of hard to navigate, and parents, it's kind of a, there's a lot to it, obviously, because we looked at one category within each. Can you imagine? You know, you open them all up. So this is really neat. So this is, I want to be a, you know, so this is where we're going to look at. That is much more student friendly. Don't you agree? So this screen is much, much more student friendly. So this is the page I would recommend if you're going to browse it with students, is to go to this page, which is in that right-hand corner. So what do you want to do for a living? So it's sort of the same. You can type in a word. It's very similar, but yet it's just much easier to look at. So what I like about this one is it says search careers. So, you know, some kids will say, well, what do you want to do? My daughter, honestly, I swear, she'll say she wants to be a rock star. Really? She's not in the chorus. She sings her karaoke machine at home sometimes, not very often, so she's not practicing very well. She's not on YouTube, you know, no fame like that. But I know a lot of kids might say, well, I want to be an NBA player, right? So how do you say to them, you don't have the skills or ability, so you say, hey, well, let's look it up. Let's find out, you know, what does like a professional basketball player do? So this is what you can do. You can go in and you can type in, you know, like basketball. I think basketball came up when I checked this. So right here it says athletes and sports competitors. So this is what it does, is it'll pull up a full page that you can print, and it tells you, you know, what knowledge do you have to have? What skills do you have to have? What abilities? What kind of endurance, verbal abilities, physical strength? So that you can ask the student, you know, do you have these? Is this, you know, what kind of conditioning do they have? So this is a really great tool to use like that too, to show the different jobs. And every job you can do this with. So the roofer helper, we can pull it up, and it'll create a one-page skill sheet. So any job, but you know, sometimes like I need to actually go in here. I wonder if Rockstar is in here. I didn't look, but I need to for my daughter to show her she is going to be like a mechanical engineer, not a rock star. She could do that on the side. She can move to Nashville and like sing in bars and stuff like that. But okay. So also they have on here is an interest profiler. And this is neat. I know it when I'll see it. You can browse careers. I'm not really sure. So when it's, I'm not really sure, this is the interest profiler. So it's a really quick, I took it myself. I'm not going to tell you guys the results. I might be in the wrong career. I don't know. I think bartender might have been one of the first options that came up. So I'm just saying. That is in there. Trust me, I read it. Thinking about a career alternative. So it goes in and it you can do it. But also, if you've done this with your students, if you have them do it, you can keep their scores. And you can go to this page, and if you'll see, there's a little button down here that says you can enter scores. So if you've already done it and you record their scores, you don't have to do this again to get back to the data. If you want to research some more, you can just go in and type in all their different scores in here, and it's going to pull up those same options. And then the great thing about this is that it gives you levels. Let me see, I was trying to remember, I wrote my scores down. I can't remember. So anyway, let's just go to page 23 and you're gonna see what the results look like. There's bartender, I told you, one line. So at the top, you'll see there's numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at the top of page 23. That's like a difficulty rating. So if a job is a level 5, you're talking about like lawyers, you know, aeronautical engineers, you know, it takes a lot of training, a lot of skill, a lot of ability to do those jobs. One is, you know, the simplest, two, of course. So, and it doesn't necessarily be simple by education. It may mean, like, the roofer helper took a lot of physical ability to be a roofer helper. So that is not gonna probably be a level one job. It's gonna be a more challenging job. But that's what's great about this. So your students, you can actually score them, look at what comes up as their 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Y'all can go through the different levels to see what training it takes to get those jobs. I think that's great. I mean, I think it's a great tool. And then you can click on each job, because of course they're all underlined, so you can click the job, get the data sheet, look at what's required, and move on from there. So, what do y'all think about Own It? Do you think it's pretty cool? I think it's super cool. Yep, so anyway, so that's why I gave you guys this crazy looking printout, so it kind of walks through the things we've talked about today. But there's so much more. I barely scratched the surface, but it gets you interested and kind of digging into it. So use the 3 days you have left this summer, I'm just kidding, to dig into this. We're gonna go to, so TAGG is University of Oklahoma, got a research grant, and they created and did a lot of research, and they created a thing called TAGG, which is Transition Assessment Goal Generator. So I'm going to first say that it's not free, but it's $3 to do an assessment, and that includes the student doing it, the parent, and the teacher. But what you get is great for your $3, and basically that's kind of covering some of their just basic costs. And I want you all to know they've got a lot of data in here about the research involved, how they've scored it, their certifications, all their, it's very professionally done, all the research that's gone into it, and their data. Collection process. So, all right, so here's TAGG. So let's go to, I'm on TAGG Home, I think. Learn about TAGG. So on here, I printed out for you the actual TAGG overview, which is this very first, like up here where my mouse is moving around. So the TAGG overview is just an explanation of the different items. When you see where it says TAGG constructs, that's the different things it's looking at your students. So it's gonna ask questions about strengths and limitations, disability awareness, persistence. So it's gonna analyze all those pieces to get a picture of the student and, you know, how prepared they are for adult life is really what it's gonna look at. So it's really intended, they said, for mild to moderate disabilities. So they're gonna produce actually for you transition goals. So after it's over, and I'll show you that, it actually does a PLEP, because she was asking if it's present level of performance. This will create a PLEP, and it also creates some actual transition goals that you can use. Some of them are written kind of like measurable annual goals, so they're not really in our right format. You'd have to tweak them a little bit, but it does use Common Core data in it. So it's very, they keep it very up to date with what's going on in education today. So it's very current. So in your packet on the next page, it does have student behaviors associated with post-school employment and education. And that's all those constructs, and it tells you a little bit about each of the constructs that it's looking at, what aspects of them. You know, what is disability awareness? It's the ability to report accurate information regarding one's own disability. Express types of accommodations needed. So then we're gonna look at the TAGG. I just grabbed a few slides off of this to kind of show you what TAGG looks like. So the next is disability awareness. So that's a printout I put on your sheet. So this is what, when you're taking the actual TAGG, this is what a screenshot will look like. And it's great because it has audio option and American Sign Language option. So they've really thought about their audience, so which is wonderful. So you can either do it, and so you score, it's just 1 through 5. You know, I do it rarely or do it often. So you go through it and you have the student take it, the parent take it, the educator take it. So everybody takes pretty kind of the same questions. That's just another one for goal setting and attainment. It gives you an idea of what it means, and then it has the questions again. But you get the results. And so this is what the results will end up looking like. So here's combined results. So this top one says strengths and limitations. So the student scored themselves. They ended up scoring average. The parent says, you know, barely, you know, into the average, on the below average to average line. And the professional who took it, you know, they came out you know, a little above average. So then in disability awareness, same thing. So you can tell this student has a really high thought process about themselves. This would be my daughter taking it. Hers would be way, you know, oh yeah, I'm really, you know, great on all this stuff, but she won't turn in homework and get to class on time and, you know, all those things, but she's really great. So yeah, so that's, this is kind of what it lets you know what everybody is feeling and thinking. And I really love the way it puts them all compared so you can see the different data. So then what it gives you in terms of results actually shows you, if you look at it, this is their greatest strength and this is their areas of weakness at the bottom. So it says, you know, this student's greatest strength, they have, you know, the student says disability awareness, family says employment, professional says student involvement in IEP. And then, you know, it goes relative strengths, greatest needs, relative needs. So it kind of lumps them in so it tells you what they need. So the student needs goal setting and attainment. So it's really great for kind of giving you some direction about what the student needs. Now here's what it does for present levels of performance. Yeah, I think you'd kind of have to edit it a little bit, but so it does give you a present level of performance for this student. And then it also, here's the some of the goals that it wrote. So the student will identify in a mock interview three tasks he or she has trouble doing and what would help to complete the tasks with 100% accuracy. So it's really great because it does give you some, so it's like for $3, it's a really good assessment, plus it gives you some outcomes that you can utilize. And additionally, too, they are using the data. If you go on and read it, they are continuing to use the data to develop better systems to work with educators. So it's not like this is a dead study. It's alive, and they are utilizing it. And there's a lot of great presentations out there about this program. So if you want to show it to anybody, you can, or here's the PowerPoints on their website. Okay, so now in your packet, there's a group called the PACER Center. Is anybody familiar with the PACER Center? You ever heard of it? Okay. Karen raised her hand. Karen knows what PACER is. Okay, so PACER is the STEP of Minnesota. So like we said, every state has at least one parent and training center. So the PACER Center is the STEP, but PACER Center is a huge organization. They not only house the parent training center, they house, what is the bullying, what's it, like a bullying organization. They have a lot of assistive technology. They're big, so they have a lot of data. Sometimes I think their website has just too much. I have trouble finding stuff, but they contain just a ton of information. So this is a link I'll give you that takes you to middle and high school transition planning. And so by clicking on the links, it'll take you to more data, like more brochures. And so I picked out a few that I thought were just kind of different and really helpful. So that's what we'll look at. So if you see this one, this Getting Started, I know mine's in color, but you can print them in color too. But you probably won't be allowed to because you're on a school budget. So it'll be black and white, just like the one you have in your packet. So. So this is about assistive technology, and it's a long one, but if you read it, it really makes you start to think about all the stuff you do for your kids, your students, that they will need to do for themselves. And I'm horrible about doing for my daughter all the time. And I know that the teachers, because she loves people to do for her, so I know they're doing for her, right? So this starts that thought process of, how do you dissect the student's day and say, these are things that aren't going to happen for this student after high school. What do we need to do to, or what do we put in place? And assistive technology isn't always an iPad or whatever. It's just even a physical tool or whatever is necessary for that student to do it for themselves, to be independent about it. So I really love that it talks through the first step, set priority for your child's independence. And as we know, sometimes the parents in the transition piece are so, it's the hardest part to deal with, because I know as a parent, I have, you know, led her in the IEP meeting. She hasn't been there. The first time she was coming, I'm like, oh my gosh, it's gonna be there. You know, it's like weaning parents to allow that process to occur for their students sometimes, because we've been in control of all their medical stuff everything going on at home, all the stuff at school, all the interactions with teachers, like, you know, I can't get her to do this, or I'm having trouble with that. And then, you know, we deal with it and get it to happen. So, you know, I think as much as you can give parents this type of a thing to read, you know, might help them think about that process, that they aren't gonna be in high school forever, and we want them to be independent adults. So we gotta start now and not be like I am, like, she is never gonna drive. That is just not gonna happen. But I know she needs to, but I'm kind of freaked out about it. So how do we get her there? You know, what kind of training, you know, do we need to do for her to be able to drive, so I don't go into panic every time she has a car key in her hand? So it's really great because it walks through the steps, like I said. Then it talks about next steps, how to explore assistive technology, because maybe these parents, maybe they've never really thought about assistive technology. And then I love the fact that most of these brochures from Pacer have examples in them. Real life, you know, this is, you know, in this case, it's Josh Martin. He's a seventh grader. He's funny with a joke, but, you know, it kind of goes on about him and the things he might need to be successful, and how the parents at home can start working on some things, and how the school can. So anyway, that was a little bit of a different one on assistive technology that really applied to transition. So the next one is, I believe it's what y'all have, it's help your young adult learn about accessing accommodations after high school. And, you know, accommodations occur anywhere. You could at church, you know, work, anywhere they may need accommodations. And, you know, I think if I said to my daughter accommodations, she'd be like, what are you talking about, you know? And they need to really start discussing, and especially as you transition into high school, what accommodations were you using in middle school? Maybe you don't need the same accommodations. What accommodations can we look at you becoming more independent about? And just really critically, because a lot of times we, you know, in IEP meetings, we just kind of flow through the accommodations. We just go, whoo, accommodations. But I think they really need to be a point of discussion. If does the student really understand it? Is it truly necessary? Or is it something we can really focus on towards independence? So I think we need to look at accommodations with a different mindset as they're in high school and transitioning out of high school. So again, this is a great brochure, and it also has an example about Meet Samantha. So it talks about Samantha. And then, you know, if they are going on to college, how do they promote, like I think Joey talked about it a lot, you know, how do you talk to professors about what accommodations you need, and the disability services piece, feeling comfortable to go, because some students don't feel comfortable discussing their disability. So they would rather do without, but they sometimes suffer. So, you know, how do we teach them to talk about it and realize it's helpful, it's not a label, it's, you know, it's just the supports they need. And we all need supports. Like Karen, I know Karen is not good at math. Amen, amen, sister. So she I know has told a lot of stories about her not doing math, not wanting to do math. If it's a test for anything, it's not gonna happen. And I love math. So, you know, we've all got something that, you know, we struggle with. So the next one is making the move to high school, tips for parents of students with developmental disability. But I think this is a great one for all parents. I read this and it helps me to talk about a timeline, because sometimes we get calls from parents and their child is 17. And 17 is, there's a lot going on. It depends on the level and what's happening with the child. But, you know, 18, they're an adult. And so if the child is gonna need a conservator, we've hopefully talked to the parents before then to start saving up potentially for that, because it's expensive. So, you know, you don't want them to get to 17 and not have had discussions. So this is a great tool for parents. And then transition to adulthood, where do we start? And what I like the most about this one is this little chart in the corner. It's really simple, but, you know, it talks about the IEP team identifies strengths. You go to measurable post-secondary goals, transition services, annual goals, course of study, other activities. Because parents look at that transition page in IEP and just, I don't get it, you know? I don't understand how the goals, annual goals relate to these goals. What are these up here that I don't understand that? And they don't ask questions. So this is a really good explanation that, you know, we are looking at things after high school. It's not just about high school in that IEP. And then the last one, documents to keep for the youth transitioning to life. And this is kind of what's in our booklet, our dude booklet. But it's important, again, for parents to think about, you know, does your child know where their birth certificate is located? If they have it, what important documents do they have? Emergency contact information. I swear to you, this is a true story. My daughter, they went and performed at a band competition, and she's moving to be a sophomore. She was a freshman. They went to a band competition last spring. They took photos, and she had to have them mailed to the house. She gave them our old address. We have lived at this address for like 10 years. She gave them the old address because she could not remember her new address. So, yeah, so, and I actually still own the house, so there's tenants in the house. So luckily I was able to say to my tenants, hey, some pictures are gonna come, and if you could just hand those to me, I'd appreciate it. So, but that, you know, I'm like, I know you know it, but, you know, maybe she doesn't. Maybe I just assumed that she knew this address, and I've always filled out stuff for her. So I think a lot of parents could learn from that, but that is a true story. So right there, I'm a bad parent that way. I do too much for her. So on another link, we've also got, it's called Guideposts, and they have a lot of different printouts, but I printed out one for you just so you could see, and it's a framework for families preparing youth for adulthood. You can sign up to get guideposts, so there'll be a link on here so you can get them. But I think it's a really great, I think if you give parents maybe enough literature that eventually it's gonna sink in what we're trying to accomplish. So you can read through this. The Landmark Colleges, the Guide for Assessing College Readiness. So this is a wake-up quiz for kids and parents to look at, really. Because I get calls from parents, and they basically expect colleges to offer the same type of services that have been offered through IEPs. And they really don't understand that the IEP ends. It ends at general education graduation or 22 when they age out. So that's it. So how do you understand, is a child really ready for the rigors of college if they're truly gonna go to college, a real college program? So this quiz I think is amazing because it, you know, if you look at the first thing, academic skills, can you read up to 200 pages in a week? Yes or no, can you? And you know, it also lets you know, is the student prepared? If you have a student, what do we need to focus on? Do you have a system for taking notes? Like my daughter would probably say no, because I've never seen her system. Can you write a paper of 10 or more organized pages with sources? Think about that. You know, do you have a way of getting prepared for exams? So it's really great. It talks about self-advocacy again. You know, this one's learning disability ADHD, but it really applies to any student going to college. Can you schedule your own appointments? You know, do you have to provide the testing? So they don't take your IEP, you know, in college. You have to provide them with psychoeducational testing to prove, you know, that they have the disability. So they've got to go to disability services with current testing. So knowing that they've got to get that done in advance. So I think this is a really great quiz. And then you score it on the back, and it tells you, you know, your areas of weakness, what you really need to focus on with that student. Then another exam I found that I think's really good is this independent living post-secondary goal. Because on IEPs, a lot of times under the independent living, I see them and they'll say, it's gonna live at home. And then you ask the parent, I'll say, is your child really gonna live at home? And they're like, well, I didn't talk about that. I'm not prepared for that. I didn't think about it. And so I think we need to really focus on, you know, what does the child see? What does a student want to do? Do they want to live at home? Do they want to venture out? I think my daughter would love to live at home so I could be her slave forever. Do her laundry and cook and all those things for her. But that's not happening. She's going to live independently. So, you know, what do we need to work on? Like teaching her to cook and teaching her to do her laundry and all those things I need to focus on with her to get her independent, buying her own toothpaste at Walgreens or whatever that is, so that she knows. And you know, this is a great one because it talks about politics, law and politics, and they'll be able to vote. So what does that mean? What kind of right is that? How do you use that right? So they may, and they may be interested in local government too, what's happening in the county, and that could be of interest. So the last piece that I got this off of Westchester University, and I think this is a great guide. It's the differences between high school and college accommodations for students with disabilities. And I love it because it's just high school does this, college does that. And this is a good reminder for parents, you know, that under high school it says IDEA, college it's ADA. So IDEA is no more. Then high school you have the IEP. The high school IEP and 504 are not sufficient, which is great. So it talks about documentation of the guidelines for each category of disability. So it really tells you what you have to do. So student, the school provides the evaluation at no cost. The student must get the evaluation at their own expense. So it, like I said, again, another wake-up call about college, because you know, we talk about college in just in the world in general. You know, President Obama was discussing college for all, and then, you know, in Tennessee, we passed the, where they get the 2 years, all the different things about college, but not every student is college bound. And there's a lot of career choices out there where they can be extremely successful without college. So it's really fun in that right niche, and I hope ONET will help you do that too. But this is kind of a good, and sometimes it's the parents, you know, sometimes it's parents driving the college train. So it's really great for parents to look at this and, you know, realize what is gonna happen when they do graduate and how to either be prepared for it or say, hey, maybe we should look at something else. Maybe college isn't the right path for our student.